What I need to warn you of is that we're at conference Back to Basics, and topic cost of delay actually is pretty complex. So I'll just touch kind of the top of it, but it will give you some ideas. Instead, I need to build up the story, why do we need to talk about it? So that's what I'm gonna do first. If quickly about myself, I'm from Accenture Latvia, I'm Nordex DevOps lead, and well, there wouldn't be any DevOps without Agile. So every DevOps person needs to be more or less knowledgeable in Agile, better if expert. Going fast today. So if you saw description of this talk, it was saying something about Donald Reinertsen. Have you heard this name? No. Any safe certified people here? 1, 2, 3. You for sure should know this name because in Safe Framework, they gave a lot of references from his talks, from his books, and so on. So who is that guy? This is how he looks like. Still alive. So that's good. That's good. I was trying to dig up some bio on him and couldn't find much really. He's kind of hiding, I guess. He doesn't want to say which year he's born, and it doesn't matter really. What matters is that he has made at least three, actually four, amazing books. They are old. They are really old. So I haven't read any of these, unfortunately, but the thing is that he's talking about so amazing things there, how we do things in the wrong way, and we still kind of don't get it. Some of those books are 20 years old. So one book which I have read is this one, written 2009, where he explains today's problems and gives solutions to today's problems, and we kind of still don't get it. After 10 years, we haven't listened to him, we haven't learned what is he saying, which was very surprising to me because things which I found in 10 years old book, no one ever told me. Not in trainings, nowhere really, not in such detail. The book itself is boring. Let's be honest. It's pretty complex. Once you get to the middle, it's like math, science, systems thinking, theory of constraints, and so on and so on. It gets pretty complex. So that's Donald. Now let's go on. So I don't know about you. In Accenture, we talk about projects every day. And we say, let's do a project. Customer wants a project. This project will cost $2 million. This project will end after 2 years, and so on and so on. So what we're trying to do typically, and what customers, what any company wants to do is, well, take something and scale it. Pretty much like that. To get more customers, let's do a project. Let's grow this thing. Simple. Kind of simple. But if we go back to kind of what really happens then, it requires an upfront view, what's needed, lots of planning, all those things. Then we start batching up different features because it feels logical. And then we start all these talks and meetings on time, on budget, who's paying for this, how much has been spent, and so on and so on. In Lean, in Less, we talk a lot about waste. And this all is waste. So hold that thought. So what we're actually trying to do, we need to talk a little about IT continuity, actually discontinuity model, which is pretty simple idea. We always have some starting state, typically in red, and then we have a plan how we will get to the green zone. Somewhere in the middle it's yellow, we're building it, we're struggling, then we reach the green part, And we somehow forget about it because either project is over or we have reached our maximum, everyone had a great release party, and then it kind of starts dying slowly. That's just natural, and empirical proof shows that. So another thing that we do a lot, and in my space in DevOps, there's such thing called DevOps Transformation Project, which I'm sorry is somewhat a nonsense, but we do that a lot. And what we're trying to do is, yeah, let's get from one state to another. It's not about growing, it's about kind of improving. So let's do agile transformation. Let's transform into safe, into scrum, into less. And we do these things. Agile coaches sell these things. DevOps coaches sell these things. Because, well, that's somewhat a business. So what happens with all of these transformation projects, just projects, is that, well, we finish one project, we want to start a new one. If we're having big traditional company, most probably there will be something like 3 years plan, 5 years plan, that after this project, we do that project or those other two projects. In real life, well, there's the red zone, that's one problem. There's even bigger problem that we never deliver projects on time. Maybe on a paper it says, yep, we delivered it, but everyone knows that something wasn't really finished. You know how it goes. So what actually happens is that we start moving those plans ahead. We had 5 years plan, now this magically became a 7 years plan. And if we're trying to start many things at once, it just escalates. So there's a problem. Okay, let's accept it. All projects fail. Well, some fail less than others, hopefully. Some statistics, it seems that slide is messed up. Yep, Maria, that's your laptop. Yeah, what it says, 14% of companies manage to turn innovation investments into results. So let's do this new thing and it should bring us money. So from data, 14%, only 14% succeed. So, okay, there's typically strategic objectives that we will achieve this and that with some transformation. 10%. Well, not very good. And probably on a paper again to CIO, it says 95. But everyone knows what's going on. 6% manage to migrate, to move to the new, kind of to new technologies, to new approaches, like for real, not just on paper, not just swap, I don't know, COBOL with Java, but have some value out of that. So the problem, as I said, in my daily life, we talk a lot about projects because we're used to that, because that's what we sell. But there's a huge problem with that. We focus on project duration. What happens after that? So obviously, instead, we should be talking about products. We shouldn't use words like projects ever at all. But yeah, let's be real and so on. Because if we start focusing on what will happen after we have delivered it, the priorities change, where we should invest, what we should do, what to do first. A lot of things change. So what we're trying to reach is this. Get out from red zone, get into green one, and stay there. Yes, there will be small ups and downs. So this is what we want for any product, not project. How to get there? I guess that's the question. We are at Agile conference, right? So everything agile. Let's do agile for everything. Well, cool. Of course, I'm not talking about this agile and a lot of memes, no documentation, no processes, nothing. No, no, we are serious folks here. We take it for real, less, safe, proper scrum, so it's not that. We need to go back to, do you know what is value stream? Kind of simple, lean concept. Some do, some are just shy. In few words, what it means is, if I have an idea, I need to process it and then get out value from it. And value stream is in between. Somewhere here is value stream. How do we get things from A to B? Simple as that. From idea to money. Nothing complex. Well, in real life, and somewhat traditionally, we're used to that. And yeah, let's talk about waterfall. What we started doing many years ago, we have 16 ideas. In this case, actually 25 ideas. Let's package them up in one nice release and get out 25 poke coins. I think that's the name. 20. Well, a bit less. A realistic plan. But it doesn't work that way, really. There's a lot of reasons why. Like, delivered too late, didn't go as planned, made something else. Very typical waterfall result. And then someone like me comes in and says, you need to do agile. Okay, they go away, we'll be agile, we'll do everything. And then they do this. And kind of again, I come in and say, this is waterfall. So what happens at many, many cases when people don't have an agile coach, let's say, they just take the plan of waterfall, split it in 3 parts, in 8 parts, in 12 parts, and execute them one by one. That's not agile. Doing sprints is not agile. And the result, of course, is maybe a little bit better because some parts were delivered sooner. Cool. But still, it's somewhat, well, it's not given the results we expected. So we need to go back to this very, very old picture. I don't know which year is that. When Pokemon was born, some 30, 40 years ago, right? I believe everyone has seen it. It's very old. But still people take it, they laugh at it. Yeah, this is how you shouldn't be doing agile. And then after a year, someone like me comes in and like, yep, you're doing that first one still. What's the difference? What's the main difference is that we are doing rework after first sprint of things which we made. We don't say it's finished. We are doing rework of first things to generate more value based on feedback. But in our large projects, how often do we do that? There's plan is set for 3 months. Let's call it a release, of course. And that's something what we need to keep in mind. How to make these things, and then I would be talking about cycles, how to make them super fast, super small, super short. And then the book which I mentioned, The Flow. In the middle it gets like this. A lot of graphs, I'm not getting into that today, which talks a lot about batch sizes. Reasonable size of batches. It talks about queues. It turned my mind around what really queue means and how to do proper Kanban and why Kanban was invented. Not getting into this, but I do suggest to read the book, definitely. But yeah, it all focuses on let's do everything in smaller, shorter cycles. Cool. If this is set, then the next thing is, we decided let's do proper agile, let's do small batch sizes, clear, cool. Now, still, we want to know at least something, when it will end, how much work that is. Typically we do. Typically everyone wants to know how much this will cost. Can you measure cost for agile project? For project you can. For product it doesn't make sense. Again, that's where projects are coming up. Yeah, well, all models are wrong, but some are useful. Very old saying. So, same thing with estimations. I will not cover what kind of estimations we have. It's not about that today. But if we quickly look in that, so traditional estimations, factor, lang, hand, detailed, page, Delphi, VBS, three-point, functional, those are most popular ones. People who are going to PMP to get certified typically know these. Well, cool. Each of them has a book like that, how to do it, why it's good, and so on and so on. If we look at something more modern, agile estimations, planning poker, the most popular one, bucket system, big uncertain. I love this one. I will not say out loud what it means, but it starts with F, and then there are four stars. So helps. For some people, t-shirt sizes, dot woten, like in design thinking, and more. So those are most popular ones. Cool. We can apply some of this stuff to understand when it's coming out, maybe. I love example from universities where they still estimate things with Kokomo. If you have seen that thing, and other tools where you just put in some data and it gives you the magic estimate. Even better, you don't need to know a technique, you just need to know how to provide the data. Amazing. Are they correct? Well, some yes, some more than others, but none of them 100%. Cool, yeah, and then someone comes in the room and says, return on investment, all estimations are useless, I want to know what's the return on investment. How you had that? Happens sometimes, and why we are doing this? What's the return on investment? Happens a lot. So what Donald said, the more detailed we made our plans, the longer our cycle times became. So the more effort you put into estimating, planning, organizing, everything gets just slower and slower and slower. It's waste. It's adding waste. So what's the point? Seriously. Yeah, and we need to think about another thing. I'm just checking time. So if we think about actual agile, how we should be doing things, if we have an idea, that, or maybe three ideas, with one goal, but three different ideas how to implement this, then instead of picking one and doing analysis for a month, we should just start building them. Simple as that, to see what's coming out of that. Okay, maybe one didn't really work, the second one was somewhat okay, and then, what's the name? Balbazar is the name. And then the Balbazar, it brings the most money. Cool, decision made. Let's stop development on those others and continue with this one. How often do you do that when you start something new? And let's try out in real market these three different approaches to try to achieve same goal. But this is what we should be doing to actually get the highest value at end. But it's just the beginning. Where we go next is, okay, we have on top this idea, do you know A-B testing? So this is A-B testing. We have idea that we could evolve this small guy, forgot the name, do you know it? Yeah? It's Charmander. So yeah, we can evolve Charmander in different colors, and some of them will return more money, some less. Imagine a small boy who loves Pokemons, and you decided that maybe he will tell his friend about the school app if you will change the color of his favorite hero of his favorite Pokemon or something. So sometimes it will work, sometimes it will not. We need to test that. But at the same time, there's second idea that what if, and I believe that's really what happened 50 years ago, or how old is this thing, that what if they could evolve? But how to find the right form, right way. And that's what's happening with our software development projects a lot. What if we change everything, break it, migrate, re-architect to microservices, very popular thing right now? It will take a lot of time. Somewhere in the middle, it may feel that, nope, we made wrong decision, but there's still some believer who says, nope, we are not finished, let's continue, and at the end, it could be a huge success story. So we somehow need to run those things in parallel. And it's easy to talk about, let's run these things, but there's always money behind that. There's always some budget behind that. Someone needs to pay for this. Except if you're doing startup in your basement, then it's cool, yeah. So it's hard. The big question is what to do or what not to do. What if I have 16 ideas, but I have budget for two? What to do? And this is where kind of cost of delay starts coming in, step by step. So another quote from Don. We should not prioritize on the basis of project profitability, but rather on how this profitability is affected by delay. To rephrase that, idea actually is very simple. So how much money we are losing by not having the solution today? That's it. Or, well, if we need to compare that, how much we are losing more money by not having this solution comparing to not having the other solution? And immediately we can start making some decisions if we know that. It's not easy, but the idea is kind of simple. Then we need to go to, and this is kind of from book word in word. I'll show you a picture. Made it yesterday evening. Yeah, where Don talks about shortest job first. Very simple concept used even in waterfall projects planning. What to do first? Well, do shortest jobs first. But there is one important detail. If cost of delay is similar, so we measure that how much it costs if we don't have it, let's say per month, and then if it's similar, we can't make a decision, then we look at shortest job first and do the shortest job first. Why? Well, if we do the shortest job first, it starts returning money, lots of money. And then the next one, and then the next one, and then the next one. Plan changes every day, so maybe not the next one, maybe the other one. Quite often, well, these are rare cases when cost of delay is the same. It's rare. So instead, usually cost of delay is different. And what's very important about that is that when we look at two things, just empirical proof shows that our guess, our guts, which one is more important, typically is not the same what cost of delay shows. What is more important? The one which is shiny or the one about which customer, the loudest customer has the most important feature? If we look at cost of delay, it may be different. So if we have like three features, similar length, similar budget needed, then look at cost of delay. Cool. I hope you're following. All right. So, cost of delay gives project teams the ability to analyze trade-offs objectively, which can really help speed up decisions and therefore the project. Even Don talks about projects. Well, that was back then, 2009. Okay. Then, and this is, do you want to read that? I don't. As I said, if someone starts kind of not mathematician, tries to dig into a topic, how to properly, to lowest detail, understand what's cost of delay for every feature, or at least epoch, it becomes very, very complex. So I will not do that. because there's one important message from Don himself. Fortunately, the last month's cost is typically enough to establish cost of delay as a valuable, understood, and agreed to metric within your organization. So if you don't go into too much detail, then actually, if we can understand in average how much money we would lose per month by not having this thing, that's a good start. Probably that's enough for today. Okay, now what does it mean? There are two ways, actually. One is, as always, one is let's make something what will bring more money, or let's make something what will save money. But the idea is the same. So what it means? The peak months of volume times the product margin. For example, so if you will sell 200 Pokemons per month and earn 20 coins for each, the last month's cost of delay is 4,000 coins. Every month we are losing 4,000 coins. Compare that to other Pokemon, you believe it will be faster to make but cheaper? Do the math and see which one actually is making more sense. You know your audience, your customer better than anyone. And if we talk about operational costs, idea is pretty much the same. So, for example, if the saving after improving Pokeball is 2 hours regeneration instead of 3 hours, so 1 hour improvement, and Ash is playing 24 hours per day, yes, he's crazy, where in each fight he earns 10 coins, that's 3,600 in a month, instead of 2,400. So the delta, the subtraction is 1,200 is the money which we are not getting this month because we don't have this improvement. Or, well, maybe we will let Ash sleep for 8 hours per day if we do this. Also cool. So, simple examples. So, where? How to use it? My personal advice is don't go to tasks level, definitely not. Depends on size of a feature, maybe to features level, but that's not the start. Start with epics. Maybe not even with epics. If you have something higher than epics, start there. Start guesstimating. Start trying to get some feeling how much money this could return us if we would have this. Or in other words, if we don't have this. Still, other things matter. How long it will take, how much budget is needed. All those things still matter to see the overall picture. So it doesn't mean that estimations are not needed anymore. No, definitely not. So one more time. So guess the peak months of volume. If you release something, at the beginning, no one knows about it. After a week or after a month, there will be some peak when you are returning the biggest amount of money. Use that. Typically, it holds on for a moment. So estimate development cost. And then something what I already shared, kind of, if estimates of development cost or time are similar, then look at cost of delay. If vice versa, look at first one. The tricky part is that usually, if we do this thing and get all the numbers, those numbers are so different that it's still quite impossible to make a decision. It's hard. But then what can be done is trying to split some things in halves, in thirds, doesn't matter, so that you get one of those lines, like, let's say, shortest job, get same number for all things you want to do by splitting bigger into smaller, and then look at cost of delay for each of those things, if it's possible. As I said, the topic goes a way deeper, which helps mathematically to understand what to do even then when it seems impossible. Yeah. And now I need my laptop, kind of. We have, what, 31? Can we log in 1 minute? We can, right? So I give you 1 minute to process this a little. Remember what you just heard. Be ready to pull out your phones. We'll do a small, well, let's try it.
I can tell you about our feedback, how we will collect our takeaways, because we would like to understand what was valuable for you. So we will use some special tool for this, and we will introduce it right after all this talk. Actually, okay, what else I can tell? It is Mentimeter, maybe you know. Yeah, we are fixing it. We already asked. And actually, okay, we can try it maybe, Max. Do you remember the code of Menti? Yes, because we have time. So first of all, you need to take your phones. Do you have?
Yeah, I've come to the hotel and told me that fixing it will take time.
Ah, we are ready? Okay. So, please continue.
Okay, we can continue. Are you ready? You're not ready. I see just 3 people right now, and there's 37. So you can use an app, you can just open it in a browser, on modern phone should work. Kahoot.it. And just enter the PIN and then enter your name. Okay, we have 24, 25, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31. We need to reach 37 at least. I don't have it. I'm the music. I'm the music. 36? I said we are 37 here. Yes. Are we ready to start? 38, 40. Don't do double logins. Okay, 41, 42, 43. Is anyone still trying to log in? Everyone seems to be ready? Cool. Now I know exactly how many people we had. Perfect. See, I did estimate. I wasn't wrong, right? 44, great. Let's start. Now, like, the brain will hurt. I promise. Focus. Go. Win rate is 25%. The text is on top. On your phone, pick the color of right answer. Ten seconds. 5 seconds. See, as I said, it's not that easy. I can't promise that I did it right by myself, right? No one checked me, but I like did spend time on this. So, well, let's go forward. So that was the easy one, by the way. 8 people got it right. Cool. Ready for next one? Go. We know who's on top. Is that you? Do we have another Maria? Okay. Ladies win today. What kind of coincidence is that? Go. PB is Pokeball. C is coins. Whoa! Good, very good, much better, very good. So something was wrong with that first one, I believe. Or maybe you're getting better at this. Cool, so who's on top now? Maria, not good enough. Inga did an amazing job. Anna, still for second place. So the last most complex question, where I will give you 3 times more time. We don't have what? Time? What do you mean? 2 minutes. I feel people are just clicking buttons. Are you done? Okay. Skip? I don't want to skip. I hope it works. Okay, 16 people got it right. The idea is very simple. You can't go over 100%. Okay, and the winner is Inga, and then Anna. Good job. I don't have gifts with me, but yeah, let's give a clap. Okay, and last 30 seconds from me. Where is it? Is it showing up there? Yes or no? Yes? Yeah. Come on. Why it's not... let's click this one quickly. Yep. So we did that. Well done. Key takeaways. I don't have time for that. I have time for this. So if you're interested in more topics like that, DevOps Conference will have them as well. End of September, beginning of October, DevOps Unicorns, lots of agile topics and more topics. Come, write it down. Thank you.